رحيم، طبعا بشكر اخويا العزيز الدكتور محمد اشهب والدكتور اسلام والاخوه
أهلا
الاعزاء في
بزيتك يا
كليه
فندم.
الطب بنها على الدعوه الكريمه. وطبعا يعني الكورس ده ما شاء الله يعني بيغطي حاجات كتير جدا، وطبعا ده دي الرساله بتاعتنا، يعني رسالتنا احنا في التعليم والتعلم واستمرار الكونتينوس ميديكال اديوكيشن. بقول لكم طبعا هنا السلام عليكم ورحمة الله، اللي بيعرف عربي واللي ما بيعرفش عربي بنقول له هالو هاو ار يو. ده ماي توك اباوت توداي اباوت ذا فور ارم انستابيليتي ويتش از ذا نيو تيرم اند اولويز وي لوكينج فور ذا بون ذا فراكشر اوف ذا بوست بون فور ارم اور فراكشر اوف ذا ارم از ان بون بات نوت انكلودينج ذا سوفت تيشو بات ذيس تيرم كومينج ناو as an including that the bone and the soft tissue. So the learning object is a definition of the longitudinal forearm instability, injury pattern, anatomy of the interosseous membrane, structures involving leading to instability, and diagnosis of the longitudinal forearm instability, and what is the treatment option for the forearm instability. What is the definition of the forearm instability? It is a complex problem resulting from traumatic disruption of the forearm stabilizer. This stabilizer, three stabilizer, it's very important, is the radial head as a bony, as the interosseous membrane is a soft tissues, and triangular fibrocartilage complex, which is divided into the proximal and the distal superior and inferior radioanal joint. So the anatomy of the bio and biomechanics of the forearm stabilizer, we have to know about that the structure of the proximal or superior radioulnar joint, which is the articular surface, which is composed of radial notch of the ulna, annular ligament, and head of the radius and the capillary of the humerus. A very important, the radial notch, which is locating lateral aspect of the proximal ulna, and the annular ligament attached is a circular in shape and is a ring surrounding the head of the radius. What about the articulation of the proximal radioulnar joint? It is in a bony, which is the head of the radius and the radial notch of the ulna, and the soft tissues is the annular ligament. The distal radioulnar articulation, which is the bony, is the head of the ulna and the ulnar notch of the radius, and the soft tissues is the triangular fibrocartilage complex, and the head of the ulna attached to the ulnar notch and the radial articulation. The ligament, which is a very important structure, the proximal radioulnar joint have three ligaments. This is the annular ligament, quadrate ligament, and oblique cord ligaments. This is the annular ligament, this is the quadrate ligament, and this is the oblique cord ligament. This is for the proximal radioulnar joint. What about the distal radioulnar joint? The distal radioulnar joint has a three ligament, which is important: dorsal radioulnar joint, distal radioulnar ligament, palmar radioulnar ligament, and the interosseous ligaments. This is the annular ligament, and this is the shape of the annular ligament. How they are rotating around the head of the radius, and the lateral aspect and enforcement, and attached to the ulnar notch. The quadrate ligament, which is an important structure, extended from the inferior edge of the radial notch to the ulna, and its main function is helping maintaining the radial head in opposition to the radial notch, very important functions. What are the oblique cord? It is a flat fascial band on the ventral of the forearm. This is the oblique cord, and its function is significant. Functional significance is not clear. It may assist in preventing separation of the radius from the ulna. This is a distal radioulnar joint with attached to the ulnar notch of the radius. This is the ulnar notch and the articular disc and the head of the ulna. The ulnar notch of the radius is a structure which is located distal end of the radius along the interosseous border. Articular disc is very important. It's called the triangular fibrocartilage because of its triangular shape, and its function is providing stability for the inferior radioulnar joint. The ligament is in the palmar, is the palmar and the dorsal radioulnar joint. It is attached to the ulnar fovea and the base of the anal styloid. While interosseous membrane, it is in a part here. That is why we do an acabangia, don't passing this part. This function is maintaining the space between the radius and the ulna during the forearm rotation. It's a very important part, providing stabilization at post proximal and the distal radio ulnar joint. And what is about the interosseous membrane? This is a very important structure, transmitting or attaching the radius to the ulna and transmitting the force. The interosseous membrane is composed of five ligaments. This is the main one is the central band, which is the key portion for reconstruction in the cases of injury. Accessory band, distal oblique band, proximal oblique cord, and the dorsal oblique accessory cord. This is the structure of the interosseous membrane, and this is the main stabilizing factor, the relation between the radius and the ulna. The muscle acting for pronation and the supination is the supinator, mainly the biceps and the supinator. For the pronation is the pronator teres and the pronator quadratus. The pronation of the superior and inferior radio ulnar joint is done by the pronator, mainly by pronator teres. The pronator quadratus for the distal part, and its function is the distal radio ulnar joint stabilization. The supinator of the superior and the inferior radio ulnar joint is mainly the supinator, which has two origins, the lateral epicondyle humeral and the supinator case of the radius. The main function is the supination of the forearm with biceps tendon. The forearm unit is this, you have to consider the forearm as one unit. It is called the forearm as a single function unit composed of the radius and the ulna, their bony and the soft tissue attached, and the proximal radio ulnar joint, the proximal radio ulnar joint, and distal radio ulnar joint with the interosseous membrane. So this is the forearm unit look like a ring. This is the forearm unit, and this is like a ring. The function of the forearm unit maintains the structural stability of the radius relative to the ulna and prevent diversions, transferring load from the distal radius as the wrist to the proximal ulna as the elbow, and provided attachment for the muscle traversing the hand and the wrist and the elbow. This is the forearm function unit, the radius, ulna, and the interosseous membrane, and the neural ligament. The radial head is the primary contributing to the longitudinal forearm stability. The second stabilizer are the triangular fibrocartilage complex, TFCC, and the interosseous membrane, IOM. The three mechanisms principally underpin normal forearm function. The primary axial stabilizer of the forearm is the radial head, as a bony component. The second stabilizer are the interosseous membrane and the ligament around the distal radio ulnar joint, and the proximal distal ulnar joint is a soft tissue. So we have a bony stabilizer and we have a soft tissue stabilizer. The third principle is that the interosseous membrane is solely responsible for transferring of the load between the wrist and the elbow during compression or distraction. And we'll see it in the next slide. This is a forearm instability. The forearm is a ring concept. The key rule of the head of the radius, the interosseous membrane, and the triangular fibrocartilage complex. Double or multiple injury to the ring, it is a common to be occurred. This is the mechanism of injury or mechanism of the action of the forearm, either by compression, like pulling on outstretched hand, or handling of distraction force. This is transmitting through from ulna to the radius and to the elbow through the interosseous membrane. So the rule of interosseous membrane is loading transfer, preventing radius and the ulna bowing. This is published by the interosseous, published by Noda, is the interosseous membrane of the forearm anatomic and study. So the forearm interosseous membrane contributes to 70% of the forearm instability and can be injured in associated with the elbow fractures. Always we remember that the interosseous membrane, it is a hidden angel. So it is not, we are always looking for the bony injury and we forget about the soft tissues. So the longitudinal forearm instability can be classified into an acute injury or as an chronic longitudinal instability. The mechanism of the injury in the longitudinal forearm instability is from trauma that disrupted the forearm unit, as we mentioned, the forearm unit. A falling onto the outstretching hand impaired an axial force, which resulted in radial head fracture and TFC and interosseous membrane disruption. This resulting in three types of fractures. The main one which is Isaacs-Lopestre injury pattern, or Galeazzi fracture, or Montegna fractures. This is the mechanism of the injury, which is can cause by indirect trauma, pulling an outstretching hand, leading compression, transmitting the load to the head of the radius. And this is an example of fracture of the head radius, and this is a compression distraction on distraction over the medial collateral ligament, and this leading to either disruption or the fractures, and then complete with continuous valgus leading to fracture of the iliacrium. This is the Isaacs-Lopestre injury, which is the main responsible for arm instability. This is a fracture of the head radius, disruption of the interosseous membrane, and the distal radioulnar joint. This is a Galeazzi fracture dislocation, which is leading to fracture of the distal pseudo of the radius with disruption of the inferior radioulnar joint. And this is a type of the Galeazzi, and it can be volar or dorsal. This is a Montegna fracture dislocation, which is fracture of the proximal end of the ulna with dislocation of the head of the radius. And this is a body classification of Montegna fracture. So the possible mechanical of instability, either traumatic axial load through the forearm, this transmitting through to the radial head and leading to the radial head fracture, and it may or may not be associated with disruption of the interosseous membrane and the triangular fiber cartilage complex. This is the mechanism when you have a compression transmitting from the radius through the interosseous membrane with the ulna and the weight distributing at the elbow nearly equal to each other. But when you have a rupture of the interosseous membrane, the weight transmitting through the radius directly to the elbow from the head of the radius to the elbow and passing the ulna. But when you have also excised the proximal part of the radius, this mechanism of injury can be transmitted from the radius to the ulna, but this will not be occur. And by time, the interosseous membrane become redundant or injured or subluxated, and this leading to abnormal movement of the radius, which is leading to radial migrations. So the diagnosis is very important, may not be obviously maintain a high index of suspicious. So if the patient is coming with you, you have to make an index of suspicious, put and be aware about the forearm instability. So the acute longitudinal arm instability diagnosis, a high index of suspicious. Again, a high index of suspicious. Always history, axial loading injury mechanism to the arm. Examine of the whole upper limb is essential. Not examine the elbow only, examine the whole upper limb. Concomitant bruising, swelling, or tenderness in the elbow and the forearm or the wrist may be present. Although there is often mild wrist tenderness with radial head fracture. This is an example of fracture of the head radius, and this is an ecchymosis in the distal part of the forearm inferior radioulnar joint. And this is an example of ecchymosis of fracture of the forearm. and this is a swelling. And always this is a test, finger compression test, imaging for the C finger compression test to examine the interosseous membrane. And don't forget to examine the distal radioulnar joint by palpating the tenderness or by examination during supination and pronation to examine the instability. And don't forget any orthopedic problem, you have to examine neurovascular. And for this, just to remember, this is a simple test to examine. Ulnar nerve, you can do an a B sign, which again is resistant, and hitchhike, thumb sign, this indicated a good radial nerve or intact radial nerve. Power of the people, this is a median nerve, and okay signs, this is a median nerve, anterior interosseous nerve. Just to remember, this is a very, remember for any cases in the forearm or arm examination. So what about the imaging? We have two types of imaging. Imaging static x-rays and dynamic x-ray for elicit the forearm instability. The static x-ray, the radial head fractures, if you do an x-ray and you see that it is comminuted or with evidence of impaction, this indicated that index of suspicious. Lateral elbow x-ray, very important. There is a loss of the empty space, the space between the head radius and the elbow. Assess the wrist radiography for the evidence of positive ulnar variance, ulnar styloid fracture, or distal radioulnar joint. Always when you do an x-ray for that, when you suspect it, do comparative contralateral wrist x-ray should be obtained to exclude the other injuries. This is an example of the empty space sign. Here, there is no relation, there is a loss of the space between the head radius and the distal end of the elbow. And the multi-fragmented with migration of the radial head, the diversion of the articular fragment and the proximal migration of the radius indicates the severity of the injury. Also, this is then what we call the empty space sign here. This is the empty space sign for a normal x-ray. What about the dynamic x-ray? Dynamic x-ray, it can be done by prone grip views. They are different in the position of the ulnar variance may be observed when asked the patient relaxes and then making during pronation of a grip, there will be movement of the ulna in relation to the radius. Axial compression test, the abnormal longitudinal motion to be about a 5 millimeter or more changing in the ulnar variance under loading. This is ulnar variance may be observed during dynamic or axial compression test. This is an example of the axial compression test. This is the relation between the distal end of the radius and ulna. And when I'm making a compression, there is a disturbance in the relation between the distal end radius and distal end of the ulna. What about other modalities? We have ultrasonography, which is a very nice tool. Under ultrasonography, the central band of the interosseous membrane can be visualized. But in the tone, the central band look wavy, slack, and discontinuous, and it can be identified with up to 95% of accuracy in the ultrasonography. What about the dynamic? We have a dynamic ultrasonography. Ask the patient making a pressure, and there will be herniation, muscle herniation sign, where the volar forearm muscle through the central band defect when a dorsal direct pressure is applied to the volar component. Is it MRI important? Yes, MRI, the forearm signal and edema within the interosseous membrane to a partial tear of the interosseous membrane and the complete disruption of the central band. It is essentially to correlate the MRI with the other clinical findings. What about the intraoperative test? When you take a patient, you can do some intraoperative tests. This is a pull test. It is performed after removal of the radial head fragment and applying longitudinal force through the forearm. what this is a pull-out pull test to test for the stability. What a radial joystick test, this is a test in the pronator forearm using a towel clip and the lateral direction, the spraying of the radius and the ulna with the lateral displacement of the radius, significant positive test. What about the other tests? Extending supination position, and there is about five millimeter of lateral displacement of the radius. It is indicated that interosseous membrane disruption. And this is another test, the radial axial interosseous loading test. This is during the surgery when you are open and you can make an axial load on the radial head and there will be displacement. This is also, don't forget to examine this radio ulnar joint. This is an example of pull test. And this is an example of examination of distal radio ulnar joint in supination and pronation. And there is an abnormal movement. And this is what we call the radial axial compression interosseous loading test during surgery. And you will see there an abnormal movement of the radius in relation to the ulna. Diagnosis of the chronic instability. This is what we mentioned before. It is a diagnosis of an acute instability. Now we are moving to diagnosis of chronic longitudinal instability. Always don't forget history of the elbow and the wrist pain and the dysfunction. Grip stress is reduced when you examine the patient, ask him to make the grip. There is decrease in the grip strength, is reduced and the forearm rotation, especially pronation may be restricted or provoking pain. History of the previous axial injury, radial head fracture, which may have been treated surgically or not. There may be a prominent of the ulnar head. This is an example of the prominent of the ulnar head. And this is an example of the patient with prominent ulnar head. And the positive grip and the grinding test indicated arthrosis of the radiocarpal joint. Diagnosis of chronic instability, it is very important. It is, we are, again, I mentioned, a high index of suspicious, and the sign should alert the clinician to the possible of the longitudinal instability. This is very important in history of the patient, the sign of early failure of radial head over reduction antenna fixation, early loosening of the radial head and replacement, capitellar erosion with proximal migration of the radius should alert the clinician to the possible of longitudinal instability. What about the radiology? Radiology will be useful to demonstrate positive ulnar variance, change in the radiocapital joint, malunion of the radial head or previous surgically to the radial head. This make a suspicious for the chronic longitudinal instability. What about the management? The management is the aim of the treatment is restoring or maintain the mechanic and the motion of the forearm. Restoration is a normal load transfer and preventing or treating adverse sequelae of chronic longitudinal instability. So once the diagnosis of the forearm instability has been made, you have to divide it into either many options, either this is an acute case or various chronic forearm instability. Since the address is a specific component of the injury, when you examine it, look for the specific component. Is it bony or ligament or post? So example, radial head, repair or replace, ligament repair or reconstruct. For this strategy, so the most to be employed at the elbow, forearm, wrist or pose, and whether it is acute or chronic sitting. For the elbow, the radial head, very important. In an acute injury, the radial head fracture may be only apparent in component of an Essex Lopester lesion. The radial head should be always repaired or replaced if longitudinal instability is suspect. Repair, more challenging, a range of radial head arthroplasty implant, metallic and polycarbon bearing surface options are available. The pyrocarbon implant may be used, causing less erosion of a native cartilage, and this may be value for the presence of longitudinal instability. But the sialastic implant should be avoided because no resistance axial load. It is compressible, associated with fracture, and ended by destructive synovitis of the elbow. What about radial head replacement? This is important consideration when you do this. What about the correct diameter? It's sometimes difficult to choose the correct diameter of the head. Also, how to calculate the height and the implant length, and also the medial offset of the head and cervical cephalic angulation. This is very difficult. These four items are very important when you are thinking about radial head replacement. The treatment of triangular fibrous cartilage complex pathology or joint leveling procedure to be treated positive and variants. Repair of triangular fibrous cartilage complex should be considered. This is a very important and the first step. If you have no experience and you have the alternative, you can do an across pin of the radius and the ulna in the distal third of the forearm with this radio ulnar joint reduced. It's very important to reduce to the normal position. Also, ulnar shortening, osteotomy for the ulnar compartment, carpal abandonment. The interosseous ligament reconstruction, if you have injury, reconstructed this ligament. Always, it was demonstrated that interosseous reconstruction and combined with radial head replacement was superior and redistributing to the normal load between the wrist and the elbow than radial head replacement alone. This is the interosseous ligament reconstruction, the technique using a variety of material. Somebody use Achilles tendon allograft, flexor carpalidialis, palmaris longus bone, patellar bone graft, and synthetic graft. But the disadvantage of all this technique is insufficient tensile strength to resist the elongation under the load. This is an example of reconstruction of the interosseous ligament disruption by Mosiri using the pull-out sutures. And this is the tight rope reconstruction, illustration of the ligament by tight rope. This is an example. And this is another diagram which shows the tight rope. And this is a bone ligament, a bone grafting uses and has been published by Ashuri. And this is the reconstruction of the interosseous membrane technique using synthetic graft and in the bottom sutures. This is the ligament augmented reconstruction system and the larynx using for replace or reconstruction of the interosseous membrane. What about the salvage procedure? The salvage procedure for if there is a pain and the dysfunctions. And this is the Kabanji procedure as mentioned by Professor Dr. Ihab. And creation of one bone forearm radio ulnar cystoscopes. The disadvantage of this procedure do not restore a good level of function, only for the pain relief. Salvage procedure, the Kapanji procedure, and we mentioned the excision of the 1 centimeter from the distal end of the ulna and the fusion between the radius and the ulna. This is an example, and this is an X-ray of a case. The distal radio ulnar joint reduction and pinning. We'll go just in few minutes for angiobatic galeazzi fracture dislocation, reverse montiga, fracture of the radial head. This is called the fracture of necessity, means that this fracture needed to be treated surgically. It's typically necessary. This is the angle, the pattern of Galeazzi, the overreduction, and the TFC may be repaired and or the forearm bending in supination in a reduced position. You have to know that the longitudinal forearm instability does not occur because the central portion of the interosseous membrane remain intact. But if it is involved, this will lead to the forearm instability. This is an example of the treatment of the distal radius, And this is an example of the cases with pinning, with the K wire fixation of the distal into ulnar joint. What about the Montague fracture, the fracture of the proximal ulna with associated radial head dislocation? This will have to be differentiated between it and the transolecranon fracture dislocation. The fracture of the acranium with dislocation of the radiocapitella rather than proximal radial ulnar joint. This is a four type, anatomical reduction and fixation of the ulnar fracture and radial head reduction. This is an example of the operative technique for this with the reduction. But sometimes there is a failure to reduce the head of the radius. So think about the interposition of the annular ligament, the soft tissue interposition, the joint capsule or osteochondral fragment that can be occurred. Malunion of the ulna and failure to achieve radio, arthritis and radiohumeral joint and the proximal radio ulnar joint and the restrictions of forearm rotation. Isquiotibial subacera, which is the main responsible for longitudinal radio ulnar dissociation. It is a complex, remember again, fracture of the radial head, rupture of the interosseous membrane, and impair the integrity of the distal radio ulnar joint. This is the isquiotibial subacera with disturbance of the central band of the interosseous membrane. And this is a demonstration how it is occurred. And the isquiotibial subacera, it is leading to instability of the forearm, central migration of the radial head, restriction of the radiocarbon motion, and the reduction of the grip strength and the resting pain. The treatment here either as the wrist, the distal radio ulnar joint is reduced and is stabilized by a repair of TFC of the forearm ranged from observation and interosseous ligament, and we mentioned before, stabilization by embolization with pinning and orthosis and fabrication or ligament reconstruction or augmentation. Joint leveling procedure as the wrist, usually as the ulnar shortening osteotomy, addressing the elbow pain with procedure at the elbow and often, but not always, a procedure to reconstruct the interosseous membrane in the forearm. Radial head replacement is very important, but had a lot of complication and we mentioned before. So isquiotibial subacera, the radial head must be reconstructed or replaced. The distal radio ulnar joint reduction, pinning in the insert subination, TFCC repair questionable, and interosseous membrane reconstruction is needed. Take home message, my last slide. Stability of the forearm is gained by osseous and soft tissues. Rare lesion after high energy axial load, you have to suspect it. Needed to address the soft tissue injury, not bony only. Prognosis is generally poor if you are not treating this patient in a proper way. So, احنا دلوقتي في عهد الكورونا, فدي الريفرنس بتاعتي, لكن دي عشان بس شوية حاجات كده آخر الليل. الحكومة لازالت تراهن على وعي المواطن, فطبعا اديك انت شايف المواطن بتاعنا, وده صالح إلى مدة 50 سنة. ده طبعا عامل طبعا الماسك اللي بتاعه دوت ريدي ميد أو هاند ميد, وبعدين الالتزام بالقواعد الصحية رغم ضعف البيئة التحتية, فده طبعا مهم أوي يغطى مراخيره بتاع ده. آخر حاجة عودة السياحة الداخلية إن شاء الله ترجع بقى بعد ما الكورونا تعدي, فده طبعا ده المستوى اللي هنشوفه. أخيرا بعد انتهاء الحظر وترك الكمامة لازم نلبسها كده شهرين على الأقل عشان ودينا ترجع مكانها من كتر ما شدت الستراب بتاع الكمامة. أخيرا قريبا ستختفي الكمامة وتشرق الابتسامة, وطبعا دي ابتسامة جميلة خالص ليكم آخر الليل, وكل سنة وانتم طيبين. كله موز كتير لأنه طلع بيحسن الحالة النفسية. أنت فعلا عمرك ما شفت قرد متضايق, عشان كده بنصحكم تاكلوا الموز. وفي الآخر thank you for your attention. Thank you دكتور محمد الأشهب على الدعوة الكريمة, وشكرا لله لبنها ستاف وكل من يعمل في جامعة بنها. شكرا.
Thank you so much, Professor Bha, for this very interesting talk and this very funny end. Thank you so much. دكتور إسلام معنا مديريتور, استاذنا الدكتور بهاء بيه.
طبعا يا فندم، شكرا جدا دكتور بهاء على المحاضرة الجميلة وكلنا استفدنا منها فعلا يا فندم.
الله يخليك يا سلام. هو ترم جديد طبعا، وناس كتير يعني حتى بيحفظ اسئله من اسئله الدكتوراه يعني، ففي
تمام
ناس
تمام
من الحاجات اللي هي
تمام
ان احنا بنبص على البوني كومبوننت وننسى السوفت تيشو كومبوننت.
تمام
الفور ارم ات از رينج، افتكرها سميطه، سميطه ناشفه لو كسرتها في حته لازم تتكسر في حته ثانيه، فافتكر كده دايما.
تمام كان في عندنا بعض الأسئلة يا فندم بقى هنوجهها لحضرتك
تفضل
من بعض
تفضل.
الناس. First question, is it possible to repair interosseous membrane acutely?
ما حصلش معانا الحاجات اللي زي دي، لكن انت لما بتعمل ريستوريشن هو بيحصل له هيلينج، عشان كده انت احسن حاجه بتحطها ان بروبر بوزيشن فبيحصل له سبونتينيوس هيلينج.
تمام.
هتبقى اكستنسيف اوبريشن يعني.
Second question,
اتفضل.
how can تمام يا فندم. Second question, how can we diagnose the sole injury to interosseous membrane?
ما شفناش السول انجري، دايما لازم احنا قلنا ان احنا عندنا الرينج ستابلايزر اللي هو البوني، فلازم البوني عشان يجي معاها السوفت تيشن، لان هو ترانسميتنج الفورس بين الريدس والارم، فلازم يحصل فيلير لواحده منهم عشان تبقى ترانسميتنج للاذر، يعني تبقى ستريتشنج بتاعت الانتر اوسيوس ميمبرين سوفت تيشوز اكتر من الريزيلينس بتاعتها، فلازم يحصل فيها ديسربشن. ما حصلش الديسربشن ده ما يحصلش سول انجري، ما شفت يعني، انا ما عنديش خبره في حكايه ان في سول انجري للانتر اوسيوس ميمبرين الا اذا كانت طلقه بتدخل في ايدك او حاجه زي كده، دي حاجه ثانيه، دي ده مختلف عن الاستابيلتي اللي احنا بنتكلم عنها.
تمام. Another question from your experience, sir, which bone should be fixed first in both bone fractures of forearm to avoid axial instability?
هو طبعا احنا امبارح لما اتكلمنا كان من الحاجات اللي لو كان عندي بوست بون فور ارم، وطبعا ده حتى اتكلم فيها دكتور كمار على ان احنا نبتدي بالانر، وانا عن نفسي بفضل ببتدي بالانر، لان الانر من الحاجات اللي هي سبكوتينوس ريستورد، وبعد كده تبتدي بالريديوس سهله. في ناس بتبتدي بالريديوس وبعدين تنتهي بالانر، لكن انا عن نفسي كده. بس هو في الفور ارم انستابيليتي دايما فكر ان انت عندك سنجل بون هي اكتر، هي انجل مش دبل بون.
تمام فهمت. Another question, does fracture of head radius alone without interruption of interosseous membrane can cause axial instability?
ما احنا قلنا ان هي element وده المومنت وحسب الديجري يعني كل ما زادت ده، لكن هو ده index of suspicious. لو عندك head radius بس يبقى معناها فيها ترانسميشن للفورس، لانها دايما اندايركت تروما، فعشان توصل وتتحرك الراديوس وتطلع لغايه فوق وتضغط على الارتيكولار سيرفيس ويحصل فيها فراكشر، يبقى المومنت بتاع تروما ممكن تكون التروما بسيطه وممكن تبقى سيفير حسب السيفيريتي بتاع التروما والاجزيا اللود اللي حصل عليه.
تمام. يعني there's two other questions now.
Thank you so much, our dear professor, our great professor, Professor Bahaa Corona, for this very interesting talk. تعبنا حضرتك يا فندم في two consecutive days. It's a great honor for us.
الله يخليك يا محمد، والله انا
شكرا
لك ان شاء الله ربنا يكرمك ويجعله في ميزان حسناتك بالنسبه للمجهود اللي انت عامله.
ربنا يبارك في سعادتك يا استاذ.
جاي من الشرق ومن الغرب ومن الشمال والجنوب، يعني ما شاء الله يعني.